This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Young Explorer or Claiming His Fortune by Horatio Alger Jr. Chapter I: Ben's Inheritance. "I've settled up your father's estate, Benjamin," said Job Stanton. "You'll find it all figured out on this piece of paper. There was that two-acre piece up at Rockville, brought $75, the medder fetched $150, the two cows. How much does it all come to, Uncle Job?" interrupted Ben, who was impatient of details. "Hadn't you better let me read off the items, nephew?" asked Job, looking over his spectacles. "No, Uncle Job. I know you've done your best for me, and there's no need of your going through it all. How much is there left after all expenses are paid?" "That's what I was a-comin' to, Ben. I make it out that there's $365.19. That's a dollar for every day in the year. It's a good deal of money, Ben." "So it is, Uncle Job," answered Ben, and he was quite sincere. There are not many boys of 16 to whom this would not seem a large sum. "You're rich, that is, for a boy," added Uncle Job. "It's more than I expected, Uncle. I want you to take $15.19. That'll leave me just $350. Why should I take any of your money, nephew? You've had considerable trouble in settling up the estate, and it's taken a good deal of your time, too." "My time ain't of much valley, and as to the trouble, it's a pity if I can't take some trouble for my brother's son. No, Ben, I won't take a cent. You'll need it all. But you said yourself it was a good deal of money for a boy, Uncle Job." "So it is, but it's all you've got. Most boys have fathers to take care of 'em, while you're alone in the world." "Yes, I am alone in the world," said Ben sadly, his cheerful face clouding over. "But you've got an uncle, lad," continued Job Stanton, laying his hand gently on the boy's shoulder. "He's a poor man, but as much as in him lies, he'll be your friend and helper." "I know it, Uncle Job. You've always been kind to me. And a lose will be, Ben. Now, Ben, I've got a plan for you. I don't know what you'll think of it, but it's the best I've been able to think of." "What is it, Uncle Job?" "If you'll stay with me and help me in the shop, I'll give you a home, such as it is, and $50 a year toward your clothes. Your Aunt Hannah and your cousin Jane want you to make your home with us." "I'm very much obliged to you, Uncle Job," said Ben slowly. "You needn't be, boy. It's a sort of mutual arrangement. It'll be as good for me as for you. You can put your money in the bank, and let it stay till you're 21. Why, it'll be nigh on to $500 by that time." "I'm much obliged to you, Uncle Job, as I said before, but there's one thing in the way." "What's that, Ben?" "I don't like shoemaking." "Perhaps it isn't genteel enough for you, Ben," said his uncle. "I don't care for that, Uncle Job, but I don't like being shut up in a shop. Besides, it doesn't give steady work. Last year you were without work at least a third of the time." "So I was, Ben," said Job. "I'm willing to own that's a great drawback. And it isn't likely to be any better hereafter. Last year was as good as the average." "It was better," Job admitted. "The year before I was out of work 5 months." "Well, Uncle Job, I want to work at something that'll give me employment all the year round." "So do I, Ben, but I don't see what you can find unless you go to work on a farm. You're used to that, and I guess you could find a chance before long. There's Deacon Pitkin wants a boy, and would be glad of the chance of getting you." "I suppose he would," said Ben, laughing. "Would you advise me to go there?" "Well, there might be some objections, but—" "You know I wouldn't get enough to eat, Uncle Job," interrupted Ben. "Why, Deacon Pitkin's the meanest man in the village." "You mustn't be hasty in your judgments, nephew." "I'm not. I know what I'm talking about. I worked for the deacon 2 days once. He gave me 10 cents a day in board and such board. Why, I got up from the table hungry every meal, and yet the deacon reported afterward that I was a great eater. Mrs. Pitkin cuts a small pie into 8 pieces, each about 2 mouthfuls, and when I asked for a second piece, she asked if I was allowed to have 2 pieces at home. "What did you say?" asked Uncle Job, evidently amused. I said yes, and that each piece was twice as big as she gave. "I'm afraid that was rather forward, Ben. Did she say anything to that?" "She said I must be very greedy, and that boys always ate more and was good for 'em. No, Uncle Job, I don't care to work for Deacon Pitkin." "Have you formed any plans, Ben? You don't want to go on a farm, and you don't want to go into a shoe shop, and that's about all you can find to do in Hampton." "I don't mean to stay in Hampton," said Ben quietly. "Don't mean to stay in Hampton," exclaimed Uncle Joe, amazed. "No, Uncle. There's a good many places besides Hampton in the world." "So there is, Ben," answered Uncle Job, with a disregard of grammar more excusable than his nephew's, for he had never had any special educational advantages. "So there is, but you don't know anybody in them other places." "It won't take me long to get acquainted," returned Ben, not at all disturbed by this consideration. "Where do you want to go?"
"I want to go to California."
"Gracious sakes! Want to go to California?" gasped Job. "What put that idea into your head?" "A good many people are going there, and there's a chance to get rich quick out among the gold mines."
"But you're only a boy."
"I'm a pretty large boy, Uncle Job," said Ben complacently, "and I'm pretty strong."
"So you be, Ben, but it takes more than strength."
"What more, Uncle Job?"
"It takes judgment."
"Can't a boy have judgment?"
"Well, he may have some, but you don't often find an old head on young shoulders."
"I know all that, Uncle, but I can work if I am a boy."
"I know you're willin' to work, Ben, but it'll cost a sight of money to get out to California to start with."
"I know that. It will take $200.
And that's more'n half of all you've got. It seems to me temptin' providence to spend such a sight o' money for the chance of earning some on t'other side of the world, when you can get a livin' here and put all your money in the bank. In 5 years it would only amount to $500, and if I go to California, I expect to be worth a good deal more than that before 2 years are past."
"I'm afraid you've got large idees, Ben."
"You won't interfere with my going, Uncle Job?" asked Ben anxiously.
"I won't actually interfere, but I'll do all I can to have you give it up.
But if my mind is set upon it, you'll let me go, won't you, Uncle?"
"I suppose I must," said Job Stanton. "A willful lad must have his way. But you mustn't blame me if things turn out unlucky."
"No, I shall only blame myself."
"There's one promise you must make me," said his uncle.
"What is that?"
"Take a week to consider whether you hadn't better take my advice and stay at home."
"Yes, Uncle, I'll promise that."
"And you'll think it over in all its bearings?"
"Yes, Uncle."
"It ain't best to take any important step without reflection, Ben."
"You're right, Uncle."
This conversation took place in Job Stanton's little shoe shop, only a rod distant from the small, plain house which he had occupied ever since he had been married. It was interrupted by the appearance of a pretty girl of 14, who, presenting herself at the door of the shop, called out,
"Supper's ready, Father."
"So are we, Jenny," said Ben promptly.
"You are always ready to eat, Ben," said his cousin, smiling.
"That's what Mrs. Pitkin used to think, Jenny. She used to watch every mouthful I took." End of the chapter. Chapter 2. Deacon Pitkin's Offer. Ben's father had died 3 months before. He had lost his mother when 10 years old, and having neither brother nor sister, was left quite alone in the world. At one time his father had possessed a few $1,000s, but by unlucky investments he had lost nearly all, so that Ben's inheritance amounted to less than $400. This thought troubled Mr. Stanton, and on his deathbed he spoke about it to his son.
"I shall leave you almost destitute, Ben," he said. "If I had acted more wisely, it would have been different.
Don't trouble yourself about that, Father, said Ben promptly. I am young and strong, and I shall be sure to get along. You will have to work hard, and the world is a hard taskmaster.
I don't feel afraid, Father. I am sure I shall succeed.
The dying father was cheered by Ben's confident words. Our hero was strong and sturdy, his limbs active and his face ruddy with health. He looked like a boy who could get along. He was not a sensitive plant, and not to be discouraged by rebuffs. The father's brow cleared.
I am glad you are not afraid to meet what is in store for you, he said. I believe you will do your part, and God helps those who help themselves.
After his father's death, Ben became an inmate of his uncle's family while the estate was being settled. He paid for his board partly by work in the shop and partly by doing chores. This brings us to the day when the conversation detailed in the first chapter took place. On the following morning, Ben was sent on an errand to the village store. On his way, he overtook Deacon Pitkin.
Good morning, Ben, said the deacon.
Where are you going?
To the store, sir.
So am I, if you ain't in a hurry, let's walk along together.
All right, sir, answered Ben.
I think I know what's coming, he said to himself.
You're staying at your uncle Job's, ain't you? Asked Deacon Pitkin.
Yes, sir.
You don't calculate to keep on there, do you?
No, sir, he would like to have me stay and work in the shop, but I don't fancy shoemaking.
Just so.
I wouldn't if I was you.
It's an onsar tin business. There's nothing like farming for stiddy work.
The old man kept me at work pretty stiddy, thought Ben. He'd always find something for me to do.
I've been thinking that I need a boy about your age to help me on my farm. I ain't so young as I was, and I've got a crick in my back. I don't want a man.
You'd have to pay him too high wages, Ben said to himself.
A strong, capable boy like you could give me all the help I need.
I expect I could, said Ben demurely.
I was saying to Mrs. Pitkin this morning that I thought it would be a good plan to take you till you was 21.
What did she say? Asked Ben, interested.
Well, she didn't say much, answered the deacon slowly, but I guess she hasn't no objections.
Didn't she say that I had an awful appetite? Asked Ben, smiling.
She said you was pretty hearty, answered the deacon, rather surprised at Ben's penetration.
Boys should curb their appetites.
I don't think I could curb mine, said Ben thoughtfully.
I guess there wouldn't be any trouble about that, returned the deacon, whose meanness ran in a different channel from his wife's, and who took less note of what was eaten at his table.
If you think you'd like to engage, and we could make a bargain, you might begin next week.
Just so, said Ben.
The deacon looked at him rather sharply, but Ben didn't appear to intend any disrespect in repeating his favorite phrase.
Did your father leave you much?
Inquired Deacon Pitkin.
A few $100, said Ben carelessly.
Indeed, said the deacon, gratified.
What are you going to do with it?
Uncle Job thinks it would be best to put it in the bank.
Just so.
It would fetch you some interest every year enough to clothe you, likely.
I'll tell you what I'll do, Ben. I'll give you your board the first year, and your interest will buy your clothes.
The second year, I'll give you $20 in board, and maybe 20 more the third year.
Ben shook his head.
I guess we can't make a bargain, Deacon Pitkin, he said.
Deacon Pitkin knew that he had made a very mean offer, and felt that he could afford to increase it somewhat, but he was a close hand at a bargain, and meant to get Ben as cheap as he could.
What was you expectin'? He asked cautiously.
You must remember that you're only a boy, and can't expect men's wages.
Ben had no idea, as we know, of engaging to work for Deacon Pitkin at all. But he decided that the easiest way to avoid it was to put such a value on his services as to frighten the old man.
I am almost as strong as a man, he said, and I can earn a great deal more than my board the first year.
I might be willing to give you $20 the first year, said the deacon.
I've been thinking,
said Ben soberly, that I ought to have $150 and board the first year. Deacon Pitkin fairly gasped for breath. He was fairly overpowered by Ben's audacity.
$150, he ejaculated, turning his wrinkled face toward our hero.
That's about the figure, said Ben cheerfully.
$150 and board, or $300, and I'll board with my uncle.
Is the boy crazy? Asked the deacon in a bewildered tone.
You'd have to pay a man as much as $20 a month, pursued Ben.
That's about $100 a year more.
Benjamin, said the deacon solemnly, do you want to ruin me?
No, sir, I hope not, answered our hero innocently.
Then why do you ask such an unheard of price?
I think I'm worth it, said Ben.
Boys haven't much judgment, said the deacon.
You'd better let me talk over this matter with your Uncle Job.
It won't be any use, Deacon Pitkin. Uncle Job won't interfere with me.
You can't get such wages anywhere.
You'll have to work for less.
Perhaps I can't get my price in Hampton, said Ben.
Of course you can't. There ain't no one going to pay you men's wages.
Perhaps you are right, Deacon Pitkin.
In that case, my mind is made up.
What will you do? Asked the deacon, showing some curiosity.
I'll leave town.
It's a resky thing, Benjamin. You ain't old enough to take care of yourself.
I think I can do it.
Deacon Pitkin. I am not afraid to try.
Still, if you'll give me $150 and board.
You must think I'm crazy, said the deacon hastily.
I don't throw money away that way.
Then I'm afraid we can't make a bargain, Deacon.
Here is the store, and I'll bid you good morning.
If you think better of my offer, you can let me know, Benjamin.
You can talk it over with your uncle.
All right, sir. If you think better of mine, just let me know within a week, or I may be gone from Hampton.
That's a Chris boy, said the deacon meditatively.
He's got the most conceited idea of his valley to work of any boy I ever came across.
$150 and board.
What'll Mrs. Pitkin say when I tell her?
She ain't much sot on the boy's coming anyway.
She thinks he's too hardy, but I don't mind that so much.
He's strong and good to work, and he's the only boy in town that would suit me.
I wonder what the deacon thinks of me, soliloquized Ben.
I thought I should scare him a little when I named my price.
If I'd thought he would take me at that figure, I'd have said more.
It wouldn't suit me to work for him at all.
In the evening, Deacon Pitkin came over to see Job Stanton and renewed his offer for Ben's services.
The boys got wildy days about pay, he said, but boys haven't much judgment.
You're a sensible man, Mr. Stanton, and you and me can make a fair bargain.
It won't be of much use, Deacon Pitkin.
Ben's got his idees, and he sticks to 'em.
But you're his uncle. You can make him see his true interest.
Ben's young, said Job, suspending his work, but he's got to look out for himself.
He may make mistakes, but I've promised not to interfere.
I've got confidence in him that he'll come out right in the end.
Truth is, Deacon, he don't want to work at farmin', and that's why he asked you such a steep price.
He knew you wouldn't agree to give it.
This put the matter in a new light, and Deacon Pitkin reluctantly concluded that he must abandon the idea of obtaining Ben as a helper on his farm. End of the chapter. Chapter 3. Sam Sturgis' New Idea.
During the week, which Ben had agreed to take before coming to a final decision, he had another offer of employment.
This is how it came about.
A little out of the village, in a handsome house, the best in Hampton, lived Major Sturgis, a wealthy landholder, who had plenty to live upon and nothing in particular to do except to look after his property. He was a portly man, who walked with a slow, dignified step, leaning on a gold-headed cane, and evidently felt his importance. His son Sam was a chip of the old block. He condescended to associate with the village boys, because solitary grandeur is not altogether pleasant.
He occasionally went to New York to visit a cousin of about his own age. From such a visit he had just returned, bringing back with him a new idea. "Father," he said, "Cousin Henry has a boy about his own age to wait on him, black his boots, and run errands."
"Has he?" asked the major mechanically, not looking up from the daily paper which he was reading.
"Yes, sir. He don't pay him much, you know, only $5 a month and his board, and Henry finds it very convenient." Major Sturgis did not reply. In fact, he was too much interested in the article he was reading.
"Ain't you as rich as Uncle?" asked Sam, who was gradually leading up to his proposal.
"Yes, Sam, I think so," answered his father, laying down the paper and removing his gold-bowed spectacles.
"Then why won't you let me have a servant, too?"
"What do you want of a servant? There are servants enough in the house.
I want a boy to follow me round and do just what I bid him.
I don't see any necessity for it."
"He could do errands for you too, father," said Sam diplomatically. "We would have to send to the city for a boy, in case I let you have one."
"No, we wouldn't," answered Sam.
"Do you know of anyone around here?"
"Yes, there is Ben Stanton. He's got to find something to do."
"I thought you didn't like Ben Stanton," said the major in some surprise.
"I have heard you say."
"Oh, he's rather uppish, feels too big for a poor boy, but I would soon train him. I'd make him know his place."
"Your remarks are well founded, my son. Only yesterday I met the boy on the village street, and instead of taking off his hat and making a low bow, as he should do to a man of my position, he nodded carelessly and said, 'How are you, Major?' Really, I don't know what the country is coming to, when the rising generation is so deficient in veneration. The fact is, father, Ben thinks himself as good as anybody. You'd think, by the way he speaks to me, that he considered himself my equal.
That is one of the evils incident to a republican form of government," said the major pompously. "For my part, I prefer the English social system, where the gentry are treated with proper deference."
"Well, father, may I engage Ben as my servant?"
"I am afraid you would not find him properly subordinate."
"Just leave that to me," said Sam confidently. "If I can't teach him his place, then nobody can. I should enjoy having him to order about."
Sam generally carried his point with his father, and the present instance was no exception.
"I don't know that I have any particular objection," said the major.
"How much wages may I offer, father?"
"The same that your cousin Henry's servant gets."
"All right, sir," said Sam with satisfaction. "I guess I'll go round and see him about it this afternoon. I suppose he can come any time."
"Yes, my son."
As Sam went out of the room, his father thought complacently, "My son has all the pride and instincts of a gentleman. He will do credit to the family." Few persons in the village would have agreed with the major. Sam Sturgis was decidedly unpopular. No boy who puts on airs is likely to be a favorite with any class of persons, and Sam put on rather more than he was entitled to. From time to time he received a rebuff, but still money will tell. He had his followers and sycophants, but we may be sure that Ben was not numbered among them. It was quite useless for Sam to patronize him. He would not be patronized, but persisted in treating the major's son with the most exasperating familiarity. Of course, this would be impossible if he became Sam's servant, and this more than anything else was the motive of the young aristocrat in wishing to engage him. As to conferring a favor on Ben, that was the last thing in his thoughts. Sam bent his steps toward the humble home of Job Stanton, but he did not have to go the whole distance. He met Ben with a fishing pole over his shoulder.
"How are you, Sam?" was Ben's familiar greeting. "Want to go fishing with me?"
"He's entirely too familiar," thought Sam. "I'll cure him of that when he is under my orders." At present, Sam did not think it politic to express his feelings on the subject. Ben was so independent that it might frustrate his plan.
I will walk along with you, Ben, said Sam condescendingly.
All right. Haven't you got a fishing pole at home?
Yes, I have a very handsome one. It cost $5.
Then it's rather ahead of mine, said Ben.
I should say so, remarked Sam, surveying Ben's pole with contempt.
But I'll bet you can't catch as many fish with it, said Ben promptly.
I don't think it makes much difference to the fish, he added with a laugh. WHTHER they are caught with a $5 pole or a 5-cent one.
Very likely, said Sam briefly, but I prefer to use a nice pole.
Oh, there's no objection, said Ben, if you fancy it.
It doesn't make any difference to me.
When are you going to work? Asked Sam abruptly.
I am working every day, that is, I am helping Uncle Job.
But I suppose you mean to get regular work somewhere, don't you?
What's he after, I wonder?
Thought Ben.
Maybe I do, he said aloud.
Perhaps I can throw something in your way, said Sam in a patronizing way.
You are very kind, said Ben, who supposed Sam had heard of some business position which he could fill.
Our hero decided that perhaps he had misjudged the major's son, and he was prepared to make amends.
If you get me a position, I shall be much obliged.
The fact is, said Sam, I should find...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.